One of the things that connects everyone here today is our lung tattoos from air pollution exposure. Air pollution exposure unites us all. Air pollution lies like a blanket across cities because we're all addicted to burning things, to combustion. We generate our energy through burning things. We're hooked on fossil fuels. Our lifestyles hinge on the carbon economy. Nobody on the planet escapes air pollution exposure. It means that we all have air pollution all around us. Our lung tattoos are a permanent record of our exposures to that air pollution that stays with us for a lifetime. It's estimated that around 10 million deaths per year are related to air pollution. That's more than all of the murders, all of the wars, all of the terrorism every year added up together. All the things we worry about, and yet we live in air pollution every day and we accept it. Even COVID, more people die every year from air pollution than have died from COVID so far. And look at the response that we've had to COVID. We changed laws. We changed our behaviours. We made a difference. We reduced the spread of this virus. But with air pollution, we don't. Remember the COVID mantra, follow the science. That doesn't apply to air pollution because we've known for over three decades that these effects are taking place, that these deaths occur. We don't follow the science for air pollution. So why not? Why has it taken us so long to make a difference on air pollution? Why have we not got effective policy to deal with that? Where are the laws that need to change? Well, fossil fuels are still subsidised by governments. Fossil fuels, even in England, are subsidised. Just recently, the red diesel subsidy was removed in April 2022. It was just removed. It doubled the price of red diesel overnight. So sometimes we don't act when the science shows us the right way to go. But we can't just accept it. We need to look for an exit from the carbon economy. Because air pollution is not just the only environmental impact. This week, we all experienced the highest temperatures ever recorded in the UK since instrumental measurements began. Just think about that, the highest ever temperatures in the UK. We all felt it, right? UK homes are on fire. And in the past, sometimes we've seen massive floods locally around this region because of climate change. Look at the way the Thames Barrier is holding back the tide from London. Heat waves, sea level rises, and flood risks will all increase over time, just as we predicted. Surely this is a wake-up call. Carbon needs to stop. It's so normalised. We have consensus amongst the scientific community. We know that human activity, the burning of fossil fuels, combustion, is related to climate change. That's the consensus. As an environmentalist, I've studied this for 35 years, and I was waiting for people to change, for different solutions to come through, but they haven't. The laws have not changed in the way that they need to change. And quite often people say there's no other solutions, but I know there are. Since the 1970s, there have been published papers on climate change, on the greenhouse effect, as it was called. In 1990, people decided that it was likely that human activity was related to climate change. By 1995, everybody was pretty certain. The science was confirmed. So why no progress? What are the solutions to air pollution, to climate change, to energy security? Well, we know how to generate energy without creating smoke. So why do we continue at these costs? We actually need to use all the tools in the box right now to fix this. Imagine if we can drive our cars guilt-free through a city. We can glide on canal boats through the landscape. Through nature, we can hear it. We don't have to have a belching diesel engine, noisy and belching smoke. Imagine noiseless aeroplanes. Well, last year, I had the chance to exit the carbon economy, to use a hydrogen car. So I go to a filling station, and I fill up my car with hydrogen. I take the nozzle, like you would at any filling station, put it into the tank. The difference is I have to seal it. I just click, and it seals. The hydrogen goes into the tank. I pay, I go. Just like everybody does with petrol and diesel. There's a filling station in Birmingham. The only thing that comes out of the exhaust is water. Just a little bit, just drips occasionally, you can hardly see it. While a regular car has air pollution and carbon coming out of the exhaust, and batteries need hours to recharge, this has very little impact on the environment as it travels. Electric cars and electric vehicles are heavy, and they're quite often packed out with batteries. Those batteries are resource intensive to make, and we don't really know how to recycle them well yet. The hydrogen cars emit very little air pollution, and just like electric vehicles, the carbon that they emit depends on the carbon intensity of the grid. So how is the electricity generated? So is it renewable energy? Is it coming from a power station? The carbon intensity of the hydrogen car depends on that. Batteries even work better with hydrogen. So if you have a battery car, you can make the battery smaller and add a fuel cell. A fuel cell is the technology that uses the hydrogen. And the fuel cell acts as a range extender so that the battery car can go further. It improves the performance of the car. It increases the lifetime of the battery. It makes the battery smaller and less heavy. So hydrogen actually enables the batteries. In my world, every battery needs a fuel cell. So what is hydrogen? Well, it's not a great prop. It's colourless, it's odourless, and it's an invisible gas. So I haven't bothered to bring any with me. But everyone knows actually what hydrogen is, because hydrogen, H2, is part of H2O. And we all know what H2O is, right? Yeah. It's water. When pairs of hydrogen and oxygen atoms are mushed together, they form water and they give out energy. That you can then separate the hydrogen from the water. You can pass an electric current through the water and generate the hydrogen. So the hydrogen fuel actually comes from water, just from electricity passing through it. That hydrogen then goes into a fuel cell. A fuel cell is an electrochemical type of generator. So it just generates electricity, just like other generators. And fuel cells are a family of technologies. These technologies use lots of different gases, actually, not just hydrogen. But they all use fuels that contain hydrogen. So we can call them hydrogen technologies. Those fuel cells sometimes run on natural gas. They can run on biogas. They can run on ammonia. They can run on lots and lots of different fuels. In fact, these fuel cells now run in cars, in trucks, in planes, in boats, in homes, industries and power stations. There are fuel cells running around the streets of Birmingham. But we don't really hear about them much. And many people don't know about them. So why is that? Why do we not know about the story of hydrogen? What is the story of hydrogen? Well, hydrogen is the most common element on the planet, in the universe. There's plenty of it. And it's the smallest. It's the ultimate fuel because it has no carbon in it. So when you use it as a fuel, you don't release any carbon, it won't cause climate change. And the only byproduct is water, just water vapor. There's no carbon, there's no air pollution, and there's less thermal and mechanical losses that you get with other engines. So it's more efficient, you just don't need as much fuel. So the story of hydrogen is probably just starting for many of us, and the hydrogen economy is just starting. But it's an exciting time for hydrogen, an exciting time to be here, because the products that we see now represent a post-combustion era. There's no burning, there's no carbon, there's no air pollution, and there are no fossil fuel tyrants. In fact, hydrogen is cheaper today than it is your petrol and diesel. So when I go to fill up my hydrogen car, it costs me around £45 and it goes over 400 miles. So really, per mile, it's cheaper than diesel and petrol, which is really unexpected. Most people don't know that. It lowers carbon emissions and it removes nuisance like noise and air pollution. So why have we not adopted it? Where is the hydrogen economy? Well, we have actually been making hydrogen for centuries. And that hydrogen has been used as a chemical mostly. We didn't recognise it as a fuel. So we didn't start being able to manage it, putting it into energy generation devices. Fossil fuels are so cheap, they're sometimes subsidised by governments, so they're even cheaper than they should be. And industry and banks have made a lot of money from fossil fuels. Regulators are not scientists, they're not engineers, they can't tell between different technologies. They find it really difficult to choose which is the best technology, which technology is going to win, which is the best. And there's been uncertainty seeded, lots of doubt seeded in people's minds. Is climate change really happening? Is air pollution really bad for you? And that those naysayers, those deniers, have had an impact on the progress of clean technologies. But now renewable energy technologies are the cheapest. But hydrogen is everywhere and anyone can make it. You can make it from renewable energy. You can use the renewable energy we couldn't use because there's too much of it in certain places at certain times. So hydrogen solves the intermittency of renewables. But it is difficult to manage. You have to store it and you have to control it to use it safely. So there are downsides, but hydrogen can quite literally be a breath of fresh air. Now there are some great stories about how hydrogen creates new opportunity. The history of hydrogen, it may be quite random, maybe still evolving, but it's full of pioneers, accidental discovery, no real advocates, but a few creative visionaries who saw the possibility. They saw future history. Now you won't recognise this man. He looks like a stereotypical British gentleman, but he stood next to a fuel cell that he made in the 50s. He should be a household name. His life was a real carousel. Lots of ups and downs, trials and tribulations. Did you know that a British fuel cell flew and landed America on the moon? This man is Francis Thomas Bacon, and he designed the fuel cell that flew America to the moon. Francis studied at Cambridge University and became obsessed by hydrogen. He saw it as the answer, as some other people had in the past. Jules Verne, for example, thought that the world would eventually be fueled by hydrogen. Unfortunately, he was so obsessed that when he went for jobs, he would sometimes ask, do you mind if I just do my pet experiments? for a couple of hours a week. And normally, he would take the job and he would be allowed to do this work. But he got distracted. He often lost his job because of his obsession with hydrogen. And eventually had to do the work on his own, unfunded. He was overlooked for funding. But he kept going to London and showing everyone his gizmo. He was so proud of it. He knew this was something important and he knew that this would work. And his friend said, "It's great, Francis, but what are you going to do with that? What's the market?" Unbeknown to him, JFK started the Moonshot program. An engineering firm called Pratt & Whitney were awarded the propulsion system contract to fly the Apollo space missions. But they didn't really know what they were going to use. So they started looking around the world. They heard about Francis, and they were impressed. They employed Francis. They licensed his technology, took him to America, put 1,000 people on it, and flew to the moon. Probably nobody was more surprised than Francis. Now, there's a lot of confusing information about hydrogen, a lot of greenwashing, a lot of resistance in the marketplace. We're all on a steep learning curve to understand what the possibilities of hydrogen brings. But environmentally, we're on code red. We need to solve climate change. We don't need to live with air pollution. And hydrogen can solve that. We can protect children's lungs from air pollution tattoos. We can solve climate change. We can protect against fossil fuel tyrants. We can create a future Hystory. We need to exert our consumer pressure. We need to put pressure on politicians. We need to demand these products from our industries. We need a green industrial revolution. And we need to stop tattooing our lungs. And when people tell you no, that's not possible, remember Francis Bacon. Because if he can fly America to the moon, then anything is possible. Thank you.